Hadirin sekalian, selamat sore dan selamat datang di rangkaian acara Alumni Lecture Series yang keempat dan sekaligus menjadi penutup rangkaian acara yang diadakan dalam rangka Disnatalis ke-20 Fakultas Teknobiologi Universitas Katolik Indonesia Atmajaya. Perkenalkan, nama saya Maria Averia yang akan memandu acara pada sore hari ini. Nah, untuk mendukung jalannya acara pada sore hari ini, ada beberapa peraturan yang harus diperhatikan selama acara berlangsung. Yang pertama, peserta wajib berpakaian rapi dan sopan. Yang kedua, jika tidak berkepentingan untuk berbicara, peserta wajib menonaktifkan mic agar tidak mengganggu kegiatan. Ketiga, link Zoom untuk pertemuan alumni lecture series dilarang untuk dibagikan kepada pihak-pihak yang tidak berkepentingan. Keempat, peserta wajib mengisi link absensi dan feedback sebagai syarat untuk mendapatkan e-sertifikat. Link akan dibagikan oleh panitia setelah selesai sesi tanya-jawab berlangsung. Kelima, peserta diharapkan untuk menggunakan virtual background yang telah disediakan oleh panitia saat on-cam dan saat sesi foto bersama berlangsung. Keenam, sesi tanya-jawab akan dilakukan di akhir setelah ketiga narasumber selesai membagikan materi. Peserta dipersilakan bertanya melalui kolom chat dengan format nama, underscore pembicara yang dituju, underscore pertanyaan, ataupun bertanya secara langsung menggunakan fitur raise hand yang nantinya akan dipandu lebih lanjut oleh moderator. Nah, hadirin sekalian, acara pada sore hari ini akan dibagi menjadi 4 sesi, yaitu pertama ada pembicara dari Ines Johanna Gan PhD dengan judul Metabolic Targeting of Cancer Using Engineered Gamma or Delta T Cells. Yang kedua Ignatius Joanito PhD dengan judul Single Cell and Bulk Transcriptome Sequencing Identifies Two Epithelial Tumor Cell States and Refines the Consensus Molecular Classification of Colorectal Cancer. Yang ketiga ada Stefanus Pranoto Halis, MBiotech, dengan judul Is the Antioxidant Signaling Beneficial? A Study from the Role of NRF2 in Stress Response of Cancer Cells. Dan terakhir akan dilanjutkan dengan sesi tanya-jawab untuk ketiga narasumber. Nah, sesi pada hari ini akan dipandu oleh seorang moderator, yaitu Saudari Winnie MSC. Oleh karena itu, sekarang saya akan membacakan secara singkat CV dari Saudari Winnie. Saudari Winnie menempuh pendidikan S1-nya di Atmajaya dan S2-nya di University of Glasgow, UK. Saudari Winnie pernah menjadi editor di The Indonesian Biomedical Journal pada tahun 2014 sampai 2015. Saudari Winnie juga pernah menjadi Molecular Diagnostic Scientist di Prodia Clinical Laboratory dan sekarang menjadi Kepala Lab dari Molecular Predictive and Diagnostic Laboratory di Prodia Clinical Laboratory. Nah, Saudari Winnie juga pernah menjadi penerima beasiswa Chevening pada tahun 2015 sampai 2016. Kepada Saudari Winnie selaku moderator, waktu dan tempat saya persilakan. Oke, baik, kepada Saudari Winnie, boleh.
Oke, suara saya terdengar ya. Selamat siang para hadirin panitia untuk alumni lecture series dari Fakultas Teknobiologi ya, Atmajaya. Selamat sore, terima kasih untuk semuanya telah menyempatkan waktu untuk bisa mengikuti lecture hari ini. Kita punya banyak sekali pembicara yang membawakan topik-topik yang menarik dan bisa dibilang aplikatif dan juga sangat trendy ya saat ini. Mungkin kita bisa langsung ke profil pembicara pertama kita, yaitu Ines Johanna dari Utrecht ya. Oke. Pembicara pertama kita, Ines Johanna Gan, ini merupakan postdoc di sebagai cell therapy expert GMP simulation di Innovation Center for Advanced Therapy di Utrecht sejak 2021 ya. Sebelum bekerja di sana, Ines juga memiliki pengalaman sebagai PhD kandidat di Center for Translational Immunology UMC Utrecht dan juga sebagai validation specialist for API and cell therapy products di Lonza Biologics Singapore. Nah, Ines ini juga merupakan salah satu lulusan dari Fakultas Teknobiologi Unika Atmajaya, yaitu di angkatan 2006 dan lulus 2010, kemudian melanjutkan studinya di Amsterdam untuk masternya dan juga di Utrecht untuk graduate school-nya ya. Oke, dan untuk publikasinya Ines juga sangat banyak, terutama terkait dengan imunoterapi ya. Mungkin kita bisa lihat nanti penjelasan lebih lengkap dari Ines tentang proyek-proyek yang dikerjakannya dan juga proyek terbaru yang sedang dikerjakan oleh Ines. Oke, silakan.
Hai semua, mau cek dulu nih screen-nya kelihatan nggak ya?
Nah, oke, udah kelihatan.
Oke. Ya, hai semua, saya Ines, saya alumni dari FTP tahun 2006, dan sekarang saya postdoc di University Medical Center of Utrecht in the Netherlands. Untuk presentasi ini, most of the time I will use English, but if you have any questions, just please stop me at any time. So my research project is really focused on the metabolic targeting of cancer with the engineered gamma delta T cells, or what we call stacked-based immunotherapy. So as a really introduction, I really would like to have more a general introduction of immunology, because I think not everyone have the same background. So what we can know is our immune system is consisting of two different compartments: is innate immune response, which is a response that comes from the cells that are non-specific, and this response is relatively fast, but they cannot develop a memory. That means it's like every time there is new antigen encounter, they always respond the same way. And this includes actually also chemical barriers, for example, our skin layers, and also physical barriers. And the other compartment is an adaptive immune response, which is more specific, is way more diverse, and it has to be activated or primed prior to their function. That means it has to first differentiate into a specific subset of immune cells. However, these immune responses, of course, takes longer to respond. It takes a few weeks in order to these cells to actually elicit their response. But then the advantage of these immune capacity is then they can form a memory. For example, that later on, if the same antigens actually come again, then they can actually already recognize it, and that's why the response could be way faster. So what's interesting that I want to focus in here is, of course, T cells. What's interesting is this subset here, what we call gamma delta T cells, which then share the property of both innate and also adaptive immune response. So first, like in order for T cells to get activated, it requires three signals. The first one is the signals that are generated from the T cell receptors. That's the first signals that it has to like then recognize their target antigens via these receptors. The second one is a cosmolarity interactions with molecules that also was expressed in its targets. And then the third one, after these two signals are generated, it will also produce a cytokine that further boosts the activations of these T cells. So it starts with the naive T cells, then after it gets this proper signaling, it will go into an effector T cells. So the more the well-known subset of T cells that are already mostly studied even further is this what we call alpha beta T cells that carry both alpha and beta T cell chains in their receptors, and it can be differentiated into two different cells, which is CD4 and CD8. And these helper cells that carry CD4 recognizing its antigen via this MHC class molecule, so it's the antigen itself is presented as a peptide or a protein, a small protein sections that are then presented by the antigen presenting cells. And on the other side, the CD8, which is what also known as autoreactive T cells, was then recognizing a peptide that recognized in this MHC class 1 molecule. The molecules itself looks like that. So then you recognize these short peptide sequence that are presented in these MHC molecules that then recognizing by these T cell receptors. These MHC class molecules include like HLA, DP, DQ, DR, or also that's also represented by the antigen presenting cells, like for example, macrophages. And on the other side, MHC class 1 is actually include also HLA ABC, and it's more actually expressed in the all nucleated cells. So as I mentioned, we are I'm more focusing on the other subset of the T cell, which is gamma delta T cell. So the difference is like if alpha beta T cells require recognition of their antigens presented in these MHC molecules in order to elicit the response, but gamma delta T cells doesn't have this requirement of MHC molecules representation. Instead, gamma delta T cells will recognize its target by recognizing or sensing a metabolic change inside the tumor cells and thereby elicit their activation in this case. So for gamma delta T cells itself can be differentiated in two major subsets, the ones that express delta 2 change positive that are maybe more better characterized in so far in the study, and it represents 1 to 5% of your total T cells that found in the periphery or in your blood. And then the second subset is expressing phi delta 2 negative that are more residing in the tissue. So 50% of your tissue residence is actually this gamma delta phi delta 2 negative T cells. And now coming into cancer immunotherapy, there are multiple different ways to actually, or different approaches to do this cancer immunotherapy, but the idea starts with the patients. The patients have the tumor or the cancer cells particularly, and actually what we know is that in these cancer cells or tumor cells, there are T cells that are that already could like actually recognizing these tumors and actually residing in the where the tumor is. However, somehow these T cells that was found in this tumor is not very active. So the first approach that was done for cancer immunotherapy is to take out this what we call tumor infiltrating T cells or TILs out of the from the tumor biopsy, for example, and then expand them in vitro. And then after that, we infuse back into the patients that then you could really have like a more sufficient amount of T cells or these TILs that could maybe now target these tumor cells more effectively. The second ones, we then use this, what the conventional alpha beta T cells that we found in the blood, for example, and we can do genetic engineering out of that. So the genetic engineering includes, for example, you target a specific antigen, so then you introduce a receptors that are specifically recognizing a well-known tumor antigens, for example, Wilms tumor 1 or WT1 or HER2 for breast cancer, for example. And then again, expand them in ex vivo and then reinfuse back to the patients. The second one, I think that most of us maybe already know, that's just very exciting these recent years, is this chimeric antigen receptors. That then it's is actually carrying an antigen-specific chimeric receptors that then introduce into these T cells out of the context of this TCR recognition, and then again infuse it into the patients. And the third one where is a new approach that we are actually doing is when we took alpha beta T cells and engineered them to carry gamma delta T cells receptors. I will go further into this later on, but the idea is like, what is the difference between the TCR and then the CAR itself? The TCR has this complex, so alpha change, beta change, and all these CD3 signaling domains that's required for the T cell activation. But the CAR itself is actually carrying an antigen-derived domain. So it's like it's from a heavy chain and a light chain of an antigen that's recognizing specific tumor antigens. And then it's then like linked into either costimulatory domains and then in the end a signaling domain. So the major difference is that now, as I mentioned, the alpha beta T cells is actually required to actually recognize an antigen that then recognizing in this MHC class molecule, but in the CAR concept, we kind of bypass this recognition. That means this CAR will not need the representations of the antigens in this MHC dependent manner. However, although as I mentioned, the T cells required an activation step before it actually could elicit their function. But with the CAR, since the signaling itself is already embedded within the construct itself, it will actually keep continuous active signaling. That means there is no because in terms of immune cells, you also have a feedback loop in which at some point the T cells will then will not entirely, it's not keep being active, but then it's in the end will be more dormant until it's really or needed again. But in the terms of CARs, this is not the case because this is what we call also tonic signaling. That means it's continuously active. How is this? What is then the main advantage of using alpha beta T cells compared to gamma delta T cells compared to alpha beta T cells? As you see here in the multiple different cancer types, you see that usually they have a different rate of mutations that comes together with this what's causing this actually growth of cancer cells. But not all of them have a high mutation rate. So for example, if you look into a leukemia, they have a really low mutational rate. And then in this case, then there is really limited neoantigen that can be recognized by alpha beta T cells. Well, interestingly, if we look into multiple 25 different malignancies or human cancers, then they looked into also what are the cell subsets that are presence in these tumors that then could actually kind of have a prognostic factor. Either it's in the favor of the patient, that means the more these cells is present, the better chance that the patient is actually working, actually have an antibody that's, but immune cells that can target your cells, or cells that are actually make the tumors actually grow even more. So the interesting part is gamma delta is one of the cell subset that really, really indicates that there is a favorable prognosis. That means when there is a presence of gamma delta T cells in your tumors, you really have a better chance of survival in these patients compared to the ones that doesn't have a lot of gamma delta T cells. But with this data, we know that the gamma delta T cell actually represent one layer of the cancer immunosurveillance, not only the alpha beta T cells. Now, since then, there's a lot of studies that are already done by trying to then isolating gamma delta T cells from these patients and then expand them in vitro and then also put it back in this patient. So this is a non-modified gamma delta T cell. So it's just your endogenous gamma delta that comes from the patient, you just expand them further. But however, these unmodified T cells, it's already known in this cancer, in this clinical trials that it's relatively safe treatment. However, the outcome is disappointing. They have a really low response rate. That could be one of the reasons for this response rate is then gamma delta T cells doesn't really proliferate as good as if we compare to alpha beta T cells, for example. And the gamma delta T cell is way more diverse than alpha beta T cells. So then we might expand T cells that actually we don't need, or we don't is not really in favor of the patient survival. And in order to then overcome these limitations of endogenous gamma delta, our group is actually comes with the concept of TEX, which is an alpha beta T cells engineered to express a defined gamma delta TCR. Then when we select a specific gamma delta TCR or receptors that already known to be highly tumor reactive to across different cancer types, and then we introduce these receptors into an alpha beta T cells. And alpha beta T cells carry both either CD4 and CD8. So by then, in, later on, we transducing these cells or engineer these cells into TEX cells, what we call, is then these TEX cells also still carry both the helper cells, which is CD4, and also the cytotoxic cells from the CD8. So by using this actually approach, we uncoupled the innate-like properties of the gamma delta T cells, and also like we really specifically select one receptors that we know for sure targets tumors in a good way, and then also we retain the capacity of your alpha beta T cells to proliferate a lot better in the patients. So, okay, let's continue. So my research focus is actually, okay, we already come to the concept of the tech-based therapy. But then, of course, before we can even translate this into the patient or into the clinics, we have to first test this immune therapy in a model or in a non-clinical data that we have to be generated. And one of them is using a mouse model, a preclinical mouse model. So my focus for research is to evaluate based the efficacy and also the safety of our TEX-based therapy in the mouse model. And then we also would like to see whether these TEX cells actually could persist in vivo, and then whether this persistence is actually associated with antitumor reactivity. And I'm focusing on two different clinical candidates that carries two distinct gamma delta TCR. The first one, what we call TEX-001, that carries phi delta 2 positive TCR derived from specific clones, it goes clone 5. And the other is TEX-011 that carries a phi delta 1 TCR or phi delta 2 negative TCR. That's derived from clones F11. I will go one by one. The first one is the TEX-001. The mechanism of this phi delta 2 positive T cells, it will recognize the increase of metabolic changes in the tumor cells. And one of the changes in these metabolic reactions is by the increase of what we call phosphoantigens concentration inside the tumor cells. When these phosphoantigens concentrations is actually increased inside the tumor, it will then create escalating signals that then actually activate gamma delta TCR in the cell surface of the T cell, not the gamma delta TCR, but it will recognize a ligand, which is then a BTN3 molecules on the tumor surface, and then recognized by these phi delta 2 positive TCR. Not going into detail, but if you have questions about the mechanism later on, you could ask it later. But the first thing that we test is like then, how is this TEX-001 could then differentiate between healthy cells and also tumor cells. So we looked into multiple different patient-derived acute myeloid leukemia, and then we co-cultured this leukemic cell with our TEX-001, and then we measured the interferon gamma production as a measure of T cells activation. And what we can see is like across the board, most of the time, TEX-001 could also elicit in this gray box, it could elicit the anti-immune response when is actually have a recognizing this high level of phosphoantigens. How do we know this? That's what we added in the system, is what we call spamidronate or is SPAM. That means this is actually accumulating further these phosphoantigens in the target cells. So by further accumulations of this phosphoantigen in the tumor, then you really see that there is a significant increase of recognition of this TEC-001. And this is particularly specific for TEC-001, because if we then co-culture these leukemic cells with the T cells that doesn't actually have a functional receptors, you don't see a killing activity of these T cells against leukemic cells. But then if you culture them with the TEC-001, you see a reduction of the tumor cells. So that's all good, but then we also have to know like whether then there is a side effects. That means, is it safe enough that then it specifically target tumor cells, but not their healthy counterparts? So here again, we actually looked into the multiple different healthy compartments of hematopoietic cells, so T cells, B cells, also monocyte. Why is monocyte? Because monocyte is originally is a physiological target of the gamma delta T cells for their usual tolerance mechanisms of function. So then, as you could see, none of these healthy cells is actually targeted, but indeed, monocytes elicit an interferon gamma activation. But if you see about the killing itself, like so, if we looked into the change in the upon stress, for example, while it is recognized, it elicit a significant interferon gamma cytokine production, but there are no targeting that's done by this TEC-001 across this CD14 monocyte. So you could also see, we could also put it further in a sense, if you look into a treatment cells that are treated with particular chemotherapy, so in this chemotherapy agent of cyclophosphamide or fludarabine, it doesn't elicit actually a function of gamma of TEC-001 only when it's a present of pomidronate and also leukemic cells, then the function is really present here. So that's all good, that's all done in vitro, but now we want to see whether we could sort of see the same things also in the mouse model. So what we do is then first we injected these immunodeficient mice, so then they don't have any functional immune cells, and then we infuse them with primary AML cells, and then we let the AMLs to engraft in these mice for a little bit before we actually treated them with the TEC-001 in the presence of pomidronate to, again, to also more boost the activations of these gamma delta T cells and also IL-2 as a pro-inflammatory cytokines. So what you could really see here and nicely that in the black line here, that you have a reduction of your tumor load over time after the TEC-001 treatment by TEC-001, but not by the non-functional T cells. And we repeat this in the two different models, that the second one is more immunosuppressive model, while we don't, at this time, we don't see a clearance as if, like we saw in the first model. We still see a significant tumor control of TEC-001 compared to the control. So again, we also see this the safety profile. So we then engraft hematopoietic compartments of these of human cells in these same immunodeficient mice, and then we look at the effect of the treatment of TEC-001 across these different compartments. So as you could see, while the treatment is actually really reducing tumor burden of the leukemic cells, but there are no differences, or there is no decrease in engraftment of the total leukocyte, while the T cells is present across 4 weeks after treatment. And this, if we look in details for different subsets in details, so B cells, T cells, monocytes, and also total stem cell progenitor cells, there are no difference or there is no effect of this TEC-001 treatment towards this all these healthy compartments. So we could really tell that it's really safe profile of this TAC001 that specifically targets our leukemic cells. So I will show you this video. It's really nice to see that we also look into a targeting of TAC001 for a different, for, I don't know if this video is actually gonna work. Good question. Okay, doesn't seem to work. Oh, maybe not. So we are looking into a killing effect of TAC001 against a breast cancer organoid. So the ones in blue here, oh wait, I need to do this. The one in blue is our TAC001. The one in green is our alive breast organoids. And if it's turned, if it's got killed, it will turn into this red. Now I have to do it again. You see that the T cells is really going to the to its target, to the breast cancer organoid, and start really killing them. So you could really see this at some point, this this organoid was really gonna turn into all red. That means it's really indicating that this breast cancer organoid is really killed by our TAC001.
Yes, time reminder, 5 minutes left, yeah.
So I think I will stop the movie in that way. So in this case, so you could really tell that's like we really start with a new concept like long time ago in our lab, and then we in the now we're really bringing it across into the clinic. So we are already starting now a phase one clinical trials that's already ongoing since almost 2 years, where we really infuse TAC001 as a cancer immunotherapy against multiple myeloma and also acute myeloid leukemia in the patients. And with this concept, so we really do an in-house production of this TAC001 in a GMP facility that are embedded within this academic hospital of the UMC Utrecht. And we could really then produce this therapeutic cells up to the real the dose level, the highest dose level that are intended for these patients. So that's all exciting. Of course, I'm gonna go like really fast for TAC011 because it's really it's the same concept. It's just different receptors. It's recognizing in a different way. That means it really can determine the difference between the normal cells and also the tumor cells, but in not in the same manner as what alpha beta T cells usually does. What it does is it's recognizing HLA-A2402 specific that are presented in the tumor cells. And we could really see here that only when there is expression of these HLA molecules that these cells is actually recognizing, but only in the tumor cells, but not in healthy cells, irrespective if it is still also expressing the same HLA in this case. And so then it's really, we try to bring this next to the clinic so that we really can use this TAC011 that sends a loss of HLA clustering in the tumor cells and then bring it to the clinic to like then also translate this further. Similarly, we see the same mouse model. So if we then do leukemic models in these mice, we infuse it with TAC011 and also the MOC in the tumor bearing mice, you see like a really significant improve of the survival of these mice that are treated with TAC011 compared to the control. And there are no safety issues in terms of the treatment itself. So if we just treated these mice that healthy, that's like doesn't carry any tumor, this mice is 100% surviving. That means there is no indication of there is off-target effect of this TAC011. You could also see it differently. So you, if you see based on the weight loss of the mice, so that's the first indication, if you have a, sort of a decrease in this healthy, the health of the mice is by weight loss. So you could really tell that like if the mice have a really high tumor burden, it will have really like a significant weight loss over time, but you don't see this if this mice was treated with TAC011, and you don't see it at all in these healthy mice. But they're all very nice. So we could really tell that if there is T cells in these mice, we could really target the tumors without harming the healthy tissues, and then this is potential for the clinical application. I'm not going through this part, but this is how we usually, this is just a snapshot of how we can actually follow this this experiments in the mouse. So you could really tell the tumor itself is actually carrying a fluorescent signals, that then if the higher tumor burden, the higher fluorescent signals, that you could then do this kind of imaging. And what you could tell is then the treatment of TXR11 really significantly reduced this tumor burden. And for the first time for this TXR11, that specifically carries CD8 alpha, you could really see the first time we see a real clearance of leukemic cells in the bone marrow. So you don't really see them in the bone marrow. And there is also, we can find our T cells back in this bone marrow cells that you could see here. So anyway, that's all that I want to share today. So it's really, immunology is actually very exciting. It's just that you have to dive a little bit deeper into it. And of course, I don't work alone. I have a lot of people that's helping me throughout for these projects. And that's it. And thank you.
Thank you very much, Ines. Sangat menarik ya ini topiknya. Walaupun apa agak serem juga ya mainannya tikus gitu. Dan berat juga topiknya kanker, tapi bagaimana Ines bisa mengemasnya menjadi sesuatu yang dapat dimengerti oleh kami dan juga para peserta lain. Sangat berterima kasih untuk apa yang telah Ines sampaikan. Nanti mungkin akan kita bahas lebih lanjut di sesi tanya-jawab ya. Pasti lebih seru lagi gitu di sesi tanya-jawabnya. Oke, okay, thank you. Untuk berikutnya, mungkin kita boleh masuk ke profil pembicara selanjutnya, yaitu Ignatius Yoanito. Ignatius Yoanito ini sekarang merupakan researcher associate ya di ESTAR Singapura. Sebelumnya juga pernah menjadi postdoctoral fellow di Akademia Sinica dan juga research officer di PT Smart Tbk. Ignatius Yoanito menjalani studi S1-nya di Fakultas Teknologi Biologi Atmajaya tahun 2005 sampai 2009. Kemudian juga mengambil langsung PhD ya di Bioinformatik dan Sistem Biologi di National Chiao Tung University, Hsinchu, Taiwan. Oke, untuk publikasinya Yoanito juga sudah sangat banyak, dan kita akan mendengarkan salah satu dari research terbaru yang dilakukan oleh Yoanito dan timnya, yaitu terkait dengan profiling dari, mungkin profiling colon cancer melalui mempropos adanya konsensus subtypes dari ini ya, konsensus molekular subtypes dari colon cancer. Oke, tanpa lebih mendelay waktu lebih lama lagi, mungkin silakan langsung boleh Yoanito tampilkan untuk slide-nya.
Terima kasih ya, Willy. Bentar, coba share screen. Screen-nya kelihatan nggak ya?
Iya, terlihat tapi masih tampilan ini okay. Ya.
Nah, udah. Oke. Terima kasih lagi buat Willy atas kenalannya. Selamat sore teman-teman sekalian. Pada kesempatan kali ini, saya akan coba berbagi hasil penelitian saya mengenai colorectal cancer. Actually, penelitian ini tuh hasil kerjasama antara Genome Institute of Singapore di tempat yang mana saya kerja, dan juga dengan National Cancer Centers of Singapore. Penelitian ini melibatkan banyak orang, jadi pada kesempatan kali ini saya juga akan mewakili mereka untuk menyampaikan hasil penelitian kami. Mohon maaf sebelumnya juga, tapi presentasi kali ini juga akan dalam bahasa Inggris, karena sudah cukup lama ini saya tidak menyampaikan seminar formal dalam bahasa Indonesia. Aku sedikit kagok juga nanti dalam penyampaiannya. Namun jangan khawatir, saya kita jawab apa dalam bahasa Indonesia. Jadi kalau ada apa yang tidak jelas, silakan ditampung dulu dan ditanya di sesi tanya jawab nanti. Let me try to start the presentation. In 2020, actually colorectal cancer, or what we usually call as CRC, is the third most common malignancy, and also the second most deadly cancer worldwide. And then this number of incidents is actually higher in the developed country. But it also started to increase rapidly in the middle and low income country as well. In general, older people like 50 years old and above is more prone to CRC. But in recent days, more and more new cases are found in the younger population, like when they are still in their 30s. So because of this reason, raising awareness of CRC is important to promote healthy lifestyle choices, also for a novel strategy for CRC management and implementation of global screening program, which are critical to reduce the CRC morbidity and also mortality in the future. Actually, CRC itself is a very heterogeneous disease, and its subtype affiliation is also influenced the prognostic and also therapeutic response. As a result, a lot of effort has been done to develop a good classification method to stratify this CRC tumor. And then by doing that, we hope that we can do or treat the patient in each group separately. Currently, the consensus molecular subtype, or what we usually call as CMS, is currently the state of the art transcriptomic classification for CRC. It classifies CRC into four different groups. The first one is a CMS1, or what we call as a, sorry, I think you don't see my, okay. What we call as a CMS1 or, sorry, I think there's something wrong. Can you see my pointer, sorry?
Yes.
Oh, yes. Sorry, my laptop is a bit hanging. Okay, anyway. So CMS1 is characterized with the immune infiltration and also high activation. Well, for CMS2, it's more a canonical type, and then it's activated. It shows some most common pathway that is activated in CRC, such as WNT and MYC. And then for CMS3, it generally has a lot of KRAS mutation and also have a metabolic dysregulation. And then also for the CMS4 is the metastatic subtype, and it's characterized by high stromal content. Despite being able to distinguish the most of the CRC tumor, the CMS classification is still based on the bulk RNA-seq, which will obscure the signature of distinct cell population and completely miss the microenvironment interaction. Since then, a lot of effort has been done to address this limitation. For example, in 2017, Isela et al. Proposed a new classification system called as a CRISP classification, in which the expression of human tumor propagated as patient-derived xenograft where human stromal cells are experimentally depleted. However, this xenograft approach is limited by the experimental artifacts such as that some of the humans, such as some of the tissue from the mouse is get analyzed when, because you need to develop the tumor in the inside the mouse tissue, the mouse live mouse. So because of this reason, we try to address the current limitation by utilizing the new single cell RNA-seq technology, which will able to directly address the current limitation. In this study, we're collecting data from 5 cohorts from 3 different countries. We call the CRCHG 1 and 2 for the cohort that sample that come from Singapore, Cal 3 and Cal 5 for the Belgium sample, and then also SMC from the Korean sample. In total, we will have 189 samples from 63 patients, which generate around like 373,000 high quality cells. In this study, we also will focus our analysis on the epithelial cell, which is around 49,000, which during the study, when we do the study and submit our paper, actually is one of the largest epithelial data set to that time. Yeah. After that, we also will try to validate our single cell finding using the 3,614 bulk transcriptome from 15 different cohorts. before finally perform an integrative analysis. For epithelial subtype, we found that most of the cell are actually form a patient-specific cluster, as you can see in this figure. However, we believe that this is not due to the batch effect because all the normal cells are actually cluster clumped together and then form a specific cluster, or what we call as a normal cluster in here. Next, we try to calculate a pseudobulk transcriptome from this patient-specific cluster, and using PCA analysis, we found that actually two separate groups are self-emerged with a very distinct marker, as you can see in here. This is the first group, second group, and third group. The third group is a normal. And then actually after seeing that, we try to validate this finding using another four different independent cohort, the CRCHE2, SMC, CULTRE, and CAL5 before that I mentioned. And then in here, we cluster again all the cell using the DE gene that we found previously in the heat map that I just showed you before. And then also in here, we can again see a similar finding such as that for the epithelial cell, most of them are forming a patient-specific cluster. But in the same time, we can still see a nice separation between the normal and tumor cell, as you can see in this figure here. Some sample has a much lesser normal sample, somewhat normal cell from a normal sample. But if they do have, you can see a very nice separation, which is validate our previous finding. And then also again, using the PCA analysis of the patient-specific serobulk, we again found two groups are self-emerged in these four different cohorts. Back to our ICMS marker that we found before, actually we noticed that for this particular group, the group that we called ICMS2, actually the marker gene are enriched for some of the gene that located in the chromosome 20, 13, and also 8. This result is actually very intriguing, so we decided to do a more thorough analysis using a method called inverse CNV. Here we again observe a similar finding, such as that almost all of the I2 cell are enriched for copy number variation, while for the ICMS3, they are mostly diploid. To obtain this heat map, we actually perform a de novo clustering at patient level and found that out of the 63 patients that we test, 91 of them have a consistent ICMS label compared to the transcriptomic analysis. Furthermore, we also perform a de novo clustering at the single cell level and color the cell based on the cluster ID that we've obtained in this heat map here. Here, we again found that the two subtypes were located at distinct location in the U map. And then this, which again support or suggest that our result might have our group or subtype actually have a copy number alteration that might be contribute to the observed dichotomy in the CRC epithelial cell. However, when we saw that inverse CNV result, and we found that the CNV are indeed contributing to the dichotomy that we've seen, then the next question are we only seeing this dichotomy due to the CNV or not? So to test this hypothesis, actually we try to answer it using or perform another analysis using a CNIC pipeline and try to calculate the regular activity of transcription factor and their target gene, or what we call as a regulon. Here we cluster our cell from five different cohorts using the 347 regulons that we found. And again, we found that the two distinct subtypes are again self-emerged in this analysis. 20 different differentially expressed regulon from these two groups, including some very interesting TFs, such as the TCF7, the MYC, and also some of the immune response transcriptional factors, such as NF-kappa-B, for example. So this result is pointing to a pervasive biological program differences and not only direct contribution to copy number changes. Previously, CRC tumor have always divided into two different groups. The first one called the microsatellite stable, or what we call as MSS. And then the second one is the macrosatellite unstable, or what we call as MSI high. Recently, there are a lot of interest has been put towards this MSI tumor because it's shown a better response to immunotherapy treatment, such as PD-L1. Actually, in this study, we found that all MSI tumor are found within the ICMS-3 subtype. However, in the same time, we also found that some MSS are actually clustering together with the MSI tumor, suggesting a biological problem in the I3 MSS, which are more similar to MSI high than I2 MSS tumor. Dendrogram construction based on the transcriptomic distance also pointed to distinct differences between the two major interesting subtypes, with a much greater similarity between I3 MSS and with I3 MSI compared to the I2 MSS tumor. This result is actually very interesting and very encouraging because previous study have always assume a high level dichotomy defined by MSI high and MSS. Hence, understanding the immunological makeup of the I2 and I3 MSS tumor could inform a subtype directed development of immunotherapy treatment. Next, we also try to validate this finding in the bigger cohort using the bulk RNA-seq data. Here, we again using the ICMS marker that we defined previously from the single cell data, and then use that to classify the 3,614 tumor bulk transcriptome from 15 dataset. Similarly, we observed that there are two groups of patients, one with a higher expression of ICMS2 signature, while the other has the higher expression of ICMS3 signature. After that, we try to examine the relationship of ICMS subtype with associated clinical and molecular feature across bulk data set. Here, we found that most of the ICMS2 tumor are left-sided, while for the ICMS3 are right-sided. Almost all MSI are I3, while some MSS group are also co-clustered with the MSI as we observe in the single cell data. CMS1 and CMS3 are mainly I3, while CMS2 are mainly I2. However, we also found that CMS4 can either be I2 or I3 with almost an equal proportion, suggesting that phagocytosis might be a separate process from intrinsic epithelial structure. Next, we combine the bulk transcriptomes into a single gene expression matrix and perform a de novo clustering on it. So basically, we try to validate what we do before by doing the classification using our ICMS marker. In here, we do the unbiased one. So we just all of the expression and then we just do a de novo clustering. But interestingly, we again found a self-evident organization by MSI, CMS, and also ICMS. We support that they might provide the underlying structure to the molecular classification of CRC. Unfortunately, we cannot observe a clear pattern when we try to cluster our cell using the CRISPR classification. We also observe that most of the MSI, which is the one that is a orange or yellow color, they are mostly they have a lot of immune infiltration, which was indicated by the high expression of gene that is expressed in the immune cell. Most of the CMS4 are expressing a gene that is usually present in the inner fibroblast and endothelial, which might indicate that this tumor is actually fibrotic. And then again, we found that CMS4 can be split into two separate groups depending on their ICMS status, whether I2 and I3, which might suggest that the epithelial subtype and the fibrosis are decoupled. As reported previously, we also observed that the most bad relapse free survival, or what we call usually as RFS, also can be seen in our CMS4 sample. However, the poorest RFS is actually found we found that is a feature of the I2C4 group instead of I2C4 group. The I2C4 is still lower, but actually they are not that much different compared to the other subtype actually. but the ITC4 is the worst in this analysis. Even the overall survival, relapse-free survival, and then I think there's another one, survival after relapse. They are also the bad one. This result is very interesting because it indicates that CMS4 cancer with I3 epithelium should be the focus of the biological and clinical study seeking to prevent metastasis in the CRC. Based on the previous result, we therefore propose a reorganization of the 4-group CMS into 5 groups based on upon 3 biological layer of intrinsic epithelial status, or the I, microsatellite status of the M, and also the fibros, presence or absence of the fibrosis, which is the F. Together, we name this classification system as the IMF classification. We stratify tumor into 5 classes, as you can see in this figure here. Unfortunately, due to the time limitation, and then also I don't want to cram anything to you, I think it's also not that helpful. I will just share actually the summary of biological feature of these 2 subtypes. So as you can see in here, actually for the ICMS2, most of them are having a lot of APC and TP53 mutation. They have a lot of gain and losses of CNV in this particular chromosome. They are mostly or mainly left-sided tumor. They are related to the adenomatous polyp and also have a gene signature of a cryptbatum cell. They also have the higher or greater expression level or greater pathway activity of WNT or beta cathepsin and also MYC pathway. However, for the CMS3, ICMS3, they have a lot of mutation in the KRAS, PIK3CA, and also BRAF. They have a fewer copy number changes. They mostly deployed or have some alteration, but it's in the much lower level compared to the ICMS2. And then they are mostly right-sided tumor. They are related to sessile serrated polyp, and then also shown a gastric metasplasia gene signature. They have a greater MAP kinase pathway activity, also have a higher inflammatory response, and also lastly have the worst survival rate. So in summary, in this study, we propose a new 5-way classification of CRC that we call as an IMF classification. Using the scRNA-seq, we identify 2 intrinsic epithelial cancer subtypes, which we call as an ICMS2 and ICMS3. This intrinsic epithelial dichotomy was also found in the bulk CRC transcriptome, where ICMS3 underlies the epithelium of the bulk CMS1 and 3, while ICMS2 underlies the epithelium of bulk CMS2. Next, we also found that 1/3 of the MSS tumor, which we call as I3 MSS, are more similar to MSI high than other MSS. Lastly, we also found that CMS4 is actually evenly split between the cancer with ICMS2 and ICMS3 epithelium, in which fibroblastic ICMS3 has the worst prognosis. This finding suggests that epithelial subtype and fibrosis might be separate process. For further detail, please check our original publication, which are recently published in Nature Genetics. We have also made it on open access, so feel free to download it directly from the website. And with this, I would like to thank my mentor, Dr. Shyam Prabhakar, and also Dr. Ian Tan, our collaborator, Dr. Sabin Tejpal, and also Dr. Woon-Yang Park, all funding agency, all team members in Shyam Group, and also everyone who was working in this project that I cannot mention one by one. However, since this is the alumni seminar, right, so let me mention a special in this special occasion, some of the alumni from FTB that is also present in our lab, which is Giovanni and Eureka. Thank you.
And thank you very much, Juanito. Dulu saya taunya kolon kanker itu profilingnya nggak sebanyak itu ya. Taunya baru ada MSI high atau enggak, terus apakah ada bawa apa mutasi KRAS atau BRAF. Ternyata sekarang udah ada 4 dari yang CMS-nya, terus dari timnya Yonito menemukan lagi kalau misalnya dengan single cell RNA ini ya sequencing, ternyata bisa dibedakan lagi menjadi lebih banyak subtipe lagi, dan itu berpengaruh terhadap prognosis dan juga terapi ya. Sangat menarik. Nanti mungkin kita akan masuk ke sesi tanya jawab di belakang, pasti mungkin sudah banyak yang ingin bertanya dan penasaran juga. Untuk sekarang terima kasih banyak ya Yonito. Kita coba lihat lagi untuk pembicara ketiga ya. Kita ikuti terus ya teman-teman. Oke. Terima kasih panitia sudah menampilkan profil dari pembicara yang terakhir, yaitu Stefanus Pranoto Halis, yang merupakan saat ini PhD kandidat ya di Catholic University of Korea. Dan Yonito ini juga merupakan lulusan Atma Jaya di tahun 2016 lulusnya, angkatan 2012. Kemudian juga melanjutkan master di Atma Jaya juga, dan sambil sekarang udah masuk ke studi ini ya, S3 ya di CUK. Nah, untuk achievement dari Stefanus ini juga sudah banyak, di mana dia menjadi outstanding research, menerima Outstanding Research Publication Award di 17th Annual Graduate Student Award Graduate School of the Catholic University of Korea. Kemudian juga memenangkan oral presentation di Fall Meeting Pharmaceutical Society of Korea, Jeonju. Oke, silakan. Untuk publikasinya juga sudah sangat banyak. Mungkin dari Stefanus akan menyampaikan juga hasil dari penelitian terbarunya terkait dengan respon ini ya, antioksidan ya, di dalam kanker. Silakan, Stefanus. Oke, slide-nya sudah terlihat, tinggal di slideshow. Suaranya juga sudah masuk.
Oke, halo. Terima kasih. Halo, terima kasih semua. Terima kasih kali ini buat introduksinya. Dan juga selamat sore buat teman-teman semua. Merupakan suatu kehormatan bagi saya untuk bisa sharing mengenai penelitian yang sedang saya lakukan di sini. Di studi PhD saya. Nah, ini sebenarnya nggak fokus ke penelitian saya doang, tapi ini juga merupakan kayak summary dari apa sih yang menjadi research interest saya. Nah, jadi presentasi saya ini judulnya Is Antioxidant Signaling Beneficial? A Study from the Role of NRF2 in Stress Response of Cancer Cells. Jadi mungkin Bapak, Ibu, teman-teman semua di sini ada mungkin sangat familiar ya dengan brokoli di sini. Nah, brokoli atau teman-teman juga mungkin udah sering banget dengar nih tentang apa sih, orang banyak makan brokoli dong, banyak makan apel, itu bisa meningkatkan antioksidan, sebagai antioksidan di dalam tubuh kita. Nah, untuk kasus, salah satu kasus yang cukup familiar di lab saya adalah tangan brokoli ini. Karena apa? Karena ternyata antioksidan, karena apa sih? Apa zat yang membuat brokoli ini bisa mengeluarkan efek antioksidan? Nah, ternyata setelah diteliti bahwa si brokoli ini mengeluarkan zat yang namanya sulforaphan. Jadi si sulforaphan ini bisa meningkatkan antioksidan. Nah, tapi pertanyaan berikutnya, gimana sih cara untuk meningkatkan bagaimana si sulforaphan ini meningkatkan antioksidan signaling di dalam tubuh kita? Nah, jawabannya sebenarnya adalah keep one NRF2 system. Tapi mungkin teman-teman juga jadinya bingung ya, oh, kok apa sih ini gitu kan? Nah, jadi keep one NRF2 system itu apa sih gitu? Kenapa dia sangat penting untuk pengendalian dari aktivasi sistem antioksidan signaling dalam tubuh kita? Nah, untuk menjawabnya, kita harus balik lagi nih ke London. Balik ke London di tahun 1700-an. Jadi, di tahun 1700-an itu, di tahun 1600 sebenarnya. Mulai dari 1600 itu ada kebakaran besar di London. Nah, kebakaran besar di London itu karena orang-orang pakai tungku api. Kalau misalnya lagi musim dingin, ya kita juga banyak lihat di film-film gitu ya. Kalau orang barat biasanya dia punya tungku api di rumahnya. Tapi permasalahannya adalah di tahun 1600-an mereka itu kebanyakan tidak bikin cerobong asap. Jadi setelah kebakaran besar di London, di tahun 1700-an pemerintah mewajibkan untuk setiap rumah yang punya pemanas untuk bikin cerobong asap. Gitu. Nah, tapi hal ini justru menimbulkan fenomena sosial baru dan fenomena kesehatan baru ya. Karena apa? Karena untuk membersihkan cerobong asap yang di atas itu, jadi di situ banyak anak-anak kecil, anak-anak pemuda-pemuda cowok-cowok gitu, mereka pada bekerja sebagai pembersih cerobong asapnya. Nah, tetapi di tahun 1775 ini, seorang dokter di sini, dokter bedah ya, dia menemukan fenomena bahwa di antara para pekerja di sebagai penyapu cerobong asap itu, ternyata mereka banyak yang mengalami kanker skrotum. Ya, jadi dari antara para pekerja ini banyak yang mengalami kanker skrotum. Nah, sehingga disimpulkan bahwa arang yang merupakan dia bekerja dengan dekat sekali dengan arang itu sebagai faktor dari karsinogenesis atau dari bentukan kanker itu. Nah, kemudian penelitian tersebut di-approve lagi setelah itu di-develop lagi, di-approve lagi, ternyata benar ketika tahun 1915 zat tar yang ada, mungkin sekarang kita banyak dengar tar itu ada di rokok. Nah, itu ketika dia diekspos ke telinga kelinci, dia meng-develop cancer di situ. Nah, kemudian di tahun 1960-an ketika penemuan DNA itu juga orang-orang mulai berpikir bahwa ada sesuatu nih yang antara tadi environmental factor dengan DNA. Nah, yang menarik lagi di tahun 1980-an itu orang-orang banyak menggunakan food antioxidant. Udah mulai menggunakan food antioxidant di sini berupa BHA. Nah, ternyata ditemukan bahwa si BHA ini bisa menginhibit karsinogenesis, proses karsinogenesis. Gimana caranya? Ternyata BHA itu dia meningkatkan satu enzim yang disebut quinone reductase. Nah, enzim ini orang-orang banyak yang berpendapat bahwa enzim ini merupakan enzim yang sangat penting untuk proses antioksidan. Tetapi bagaimana proses tersebut terjadi sampai titik poin itu orang-orang belum tahu. Nah, kemudian di tahun 1990-an orang menemukan bahwa di bagian promotor dari gene quinone reductase itu ada satu sekuen yang sangat unik, karena sekuen ini yang ternyata tidak hanya ditemukan di enzim quinone reductase tapi juga di enzim-enzim lain yang berkaitan dengan antioksidan. Sehingga sekuen ini mereka sebut sebagai antioksidan response element atau AR. Nah, sekarang jadi kasusnya adalah enzimnya udah ketemu, promotornya udah ketemu. Tetapi apa yang bisa mengaktifkan promotor tersebut? Nah, sampai di tahun 1990-an itu belum ada jawabannya. Nah, kemudian di tahun 1997 barulah protein bernama NRF2 itu ditemukan, dan bahwa protein NRF2 ini bisa binding dengan antioksidan response element tersebut sehingga mengaktifkan berbagai enzim yang terkait dengan antioksidan. Sehingga di tahun 1997 ini penemuan NRF2 ini sangat penting, karena pada saat itu orang belum tahu apa sih yang bisa mengaktifkan sistem antioksidan di dalam tubuh kita. Dan kemudian yang lebih menarik lagi, 2 tahun setelah penemuan NRF2 ditemukan juga KEAP1. KEAP1 adalah protein lain, tapi juga dia sangat berhubungan dengan NRF2 karena dia menstabilkan NRF2. Jadi jika tidak ada proses antioksidan yang diperlukan, maka si KEAP1 ini akan mengikat NRF2. Nah, bagaimana ceritanya HIP1 dan NRF2 itu mereka membentuk suatu sistem yang kita sebut sekarang sebagai HIP1 NRF2 system. Pada kondisi yang baik-baik saja begitu ya. Pada kondisi yang tidak ada stres, antioksidan tidak diperlukan, maka HIP1 ini akan mengikat NRF2 dan juga dengan pengikatan ini akan terjadi ubiquitinasi dan juga degradasi dari NRF2. Tetapi ketika ada reaktif oksigen spesies, ada stres dan segala macam, ROS, reaktif oksigen spesies ini akan berikatan dengan HIP1 protein sehingga HIP1 protein tidak bisa mengikat NRF2 lagi dan NRF2 ini dirilis dari sitoplasma ke nukleus untuk mengaktifkan berbagai antioksidan dan sitoprotektif gene di sini. Yang salah satunya tadi sudah disebut quinone reductase di sini NQ1, kemudian juga ada glutathione synthesis, kemudian juga ketika kita drug, kita kelebihan drug, nah itu bisa terjadi stres dalam tubuh sehingga NRF2 ini akan dirilis dan akan berikatan di antioksidan response elemen yang tadi, kemudian mengaktifkan gen-gen yang bersifat sitoprotektif. Nah, jadi kembali lagi ke sulforafan tadi. Jadi gimana sulforafan bekerja? Sulforafan yang ada di brokoli itu bekerja. Nah, ternyata si sulforafan ini bisa menginduksi NRF aktivitas dari NRF2 ini dengan berikatan pada sustain. Jadi dia mengganggu persinyalan di amino asam amino sustain di HIP1. Jadi HIP1 ini adalah protein yang kaya akan asam amino sustain. Dan dia di sini dengan ikatan tersebut, maka HIP1 tidak bisa lagi berikatan dengan NRF2, dan juga NRF2 akan dirilis sebagai proses antioksidan. Nah, kemudian berarti NRF2 bagus dong, karena dia bersifat dia bisa mengaktifkan sistem antioksidan. Nah, jadi NRF2 ini benar, dan NRF2 ini bagus, karena dia bisa mencegah dari cancer. Dengan kemopreventif. Salah satu studi besarnya adalah di Qidong, ini di China. Dia ini adalah studi yang panjang dan juga sangat lama. Jadi di Qidong ini, kalau kita lihat di sini, polusinya sangat tinggi. Di sini, Qidong ini di sebelah Shanghai, jadi polusinya tinggi dan high rate of cancer terjadi di sana. Nah, para peneliti mulai melakukan formulasi dengan buat minuman brokoli. Dan setelah minum brokoli, sulforafannya meningkat, dan kemudian juga kasus kansernya setelah clinical trial, dia bisa menurunkan rate case cancer, terutama cancer hati dan juga cancer paru-paru. Nah, NRF2 ini juga selain dengan brokoli, juga bisa teraktivasi dengan yang lainnya. Contohnya di sini ada resveratrol ataupun coklat. Dan dia juga tidak hanya terbatas sebagai kanker di pencegahan kanker, tapi juga banyak di chronic kidney disease, kemudian juga bahkan di skizofrenia, di diabetes, dan lain-lain. Karena kebanyakan dari penyakit akan berhubungan dengan antioksidan sistem di dalam tubuh kita. Nah, kemudian orang-orang mulai berpikir, wah, kalau dia bisa mencegah kanker, berarti juga dia bisa mengobati kanker. Tapi benarkah ini? Ternyata hasilnya tidak seperti itu, saudara-saudara. Ternyata orang-orang ketika mulai berpikir NRF2 juga selain bisa mencegah, bisa mengobati juga, orang-orang mulai meneliti gimana sih kondisi atau aktivitas atau ekspresi NRF2 di kanker. Ternyata NRF2, di sini kita bisa lihat, di sini NRF2 protein itu sangat terakumulasi di cancer cell dibandingkan dengan normal cell. Ini adalah normal cell, ini cancer cell. Jadi di sini protein NRF2 sangat terakumulasi di cancer, lung cancer. Di sini lung cancer cell. Dan ketika dilihat-lihat, kenapa sih dia terakumulasi? Ternyata ada yang salah dengan HIP1. Di sini ada mutasi di bagian DGR motif ini di HIP1 protein, dan DGR motif ini sangat penting untuk pengikatan HIP1 kepada NRF2. Sehingga ketika terjadi mutasi di bagian DGR ini, maka dia tidak bisa mengikat secara sempurna NRF2, dan sebagian NRF2 akan rilis dan terakumulasi dalam cancer cell. Yang kedua, ternyata selain KEAP1-nya yang bermasalah, NRF2-nya juga ternyata di sini ditemukan bahwa NRF2 juga terjadi mutasi, dan mutasinya juga mirip-mirip. Jadi mutasinya ini terjadi di bagian binding dengan KEAP1-nya. Sehingga memang banyak sekali berkaitan dengan binding ini. Dan ketika termutasi, maka survival rate replication itu akan sangat rendah. Nah, jadi mutasi-mutasi ini banyak terjadi di sini ya. Persentasenya itu terbanyak terjadi di bagian bindingnya. Jadi binding ini sangat penting, sehingga karena dapat mengaktivasi dari NRF2 ini. Dan setelah di tidak hanya di lung cancer, ternyata mutasi-mutasi dari gen KEAP1 dan NRF2 ini juga terjadi di banyak jenis cancer yang lain. Sehingga orang-orang mulai berpikir, berarti cancer cell itu dia menggunakan sistem NRF2 ini, jadi ada adiksi dari penggunaan sistem NRF2 ini. Ini sangat masuk akal karena di dalam cancer sendiri, cancer terjadi karena adanya akumulasi dari reactive oxygen species atau oxidative stress di dalam tubuh sehingga sel bermutasi. Kalau tidak ada aktivasi dari sistem antioksidan yang mumpuni, maka sel akan mati. Tetapi di case of cancer cell, dia mengaktivasi adaptif. Ya, jadi ini sistemnya adaptif, dia mengaktivasi sistem NRF2 ini untuk pertahanan tubuhnya, pertahanan sel cancer sendiri. Nah, jadi NRF2 and cancer itu, the good can be bad. Jadi NRF2 activation itu, seperti yang tadi saya sudah bilang, itu merupakan adaptif, strategi adaptif dari cancer. Kenapa? Karena di bagian normal cell, ketika di normal cell, NRF2 itu baik ya. Biological outcome-nya itu aktivasi NRF2 baik. Tadi kita udah lihat di berbagai macam disease, dia itu baik. Tetapi ketika di cancer, dengan adanya peningkatan ROS dan reactive oxygen species dan oxidative stress, maka di sini terjadi juga aktivasi NRF2 yang justru melindungi cancer cell atau bahkan meningkatkan survival dari cancer cell. Nah, salah satu yang konsep yang penting adalah untuk drug resistant. Jadi drug resistant di sini juga orang-orang mulai berpikir jadi apa efek dari aktivasi NRF2 di cancer. Dan di sini NRF2 ternyata bisa meningkatkan aktivitas dari enzim dari protein-protein yang ada di drug efflux transporter, dan kemudian dia bisa mencegah terjadinya apoptosis, dan juga dia meningkatkan proses metabolisme dari anti-cancer drug itu. Sehingga pada akhirnya terjadi drug resistance di dalam cancer cell. Nah, di sini adalah salah satu hasil penelitian dari lab saya. Jadi di sini, ini bukan studi saya, ini hanya dari lab saya, dari profesor saya. Jadi di sini dengan adanya NRF2 silencing, jika kita men-silence NRF2 di cancer cell, maka terjadi pengumpulan obat atau drug yang lebih baik. Dan juga dengan adanya silencing dari NRF2, drug efflux protein atau drug efflux gene di sini akan terjadi decrease, sehingga bisa meningkatkan akumulasi dari obat di dalam sel cancer. Kemudian yang kedua adalah cancer stem cell properties. Jadi di sini ketika cancer cell ada di stress response, maka dia meningkatkan berbagai macam persinyalan, dan salah satunya adalah persinyalan NRF2 tersebut. Tapi jika kita silence NRF2 ini, maka yang terjadi adalah tumor volume dia decrease, kemudian juga colony number juga dia decrease, kemudian juga sphere number also decrease, dan juga tidak hanya dengan silencing gene, tetapi juga dengan adanya dengan obat ya, dengan senyawa kimia di sini ya, altrans retinoic acid atau ATRA, dia bisa mentargetkan NRF2 signaling, dan juga dia menurunkan kapasitas dari tumor volume. Nah, ini selain itu di sini juga ini baru dipublish awal tahun ini. Jadi kita di sini juga menemukan bahwa CD133 ini adalah salah satu marker penting dalam cancer stem cell, yaitu bisa meningkatkan aktivitas dari NRF2. Jadi ketika dengan seiring meningkatnya cancer stem cell, maka NRF2 juga akan meningkat. Dan dengan adanya, jika kita men-silence gene NRF2 ini, maka aktivitas tumorigenik dari cancer cell akan turun. Nah, yang terakhir adalah tentang hipoksia. Jadi di kondisi hipoksia, ketika oksigen rendah, sel normal akan mati. Tetapi bagaimana dengan cancer cell? Cancer cell dapat beradaptasi pada kondisi rendah oksigen dengan mengaktifkan enzim-enzim glycolysis, tetapi dengan knockdown dari NRF2, maka enzim-enzim tersebut akan dinonaktifkan. Sehingga NRF2 knockdown ini dapat merupakan salah satu target untuk terapi cancer. Nah, ini penelitian yang saya sedang ongoing. Jadi di sini saya juga kembali saya menggunakan sistem NRF2 knockdown. Di sini dengan adanya sistem NRF2 knockdown, tumor tidak terjadi. Kemudian berbagai cancer stem cell marker juga semakin cancer stem cell marker akan terinhibisi dengan adanya knockdown dari NRF2. Dan di penelitian saya di sini, saya mengpropos HIF2 alpha sebagai salah satu target untuk resistensi dari cancer ini. Nah, konklusinya, jadi NRF2 itu baik atau buruk, dan apakah antioksidan signaling itu beneficial? Nah, jawabannya ternyata harus dibagi tergantung konteksnya. Jadi, jika untuk kemo preventif, NRF2 bisa baik, tapi jika untuk penanggulangan kanker, kita harus berpikir dua kali, atau pengobatan kanker, kita harus berpikir dua kali apakah kita harus mengaktifkan atau menginhibisi aktivitas dari NRF2 ini. Sehingga take home message-nya untuk presentasi saya hari ini adalah, ternyata mencegah itu lebih gampang daripada mengobati, karena mencegah kita bisa makan makanan bergizi yang banyak mengandung antioksidan sebelum kita terkena kanker, dan juga everything should be in balance. Jadi setelah ini jangan lupa enjoy weekend Bapak Ibu sekalian. Ya, saya ingin berterima kasih kepada teman-teman saya dan juga profesor, terutama profesor saya di lab, kemudian teman-teman saya dan juga postdoc dan juga alumni dari lab saya. Ya, terima kasih.
Terima kasih Stefanus. Jadi ternyata pedang bermata dua ya kayaknya ya. Tergantung untuk situasinya seperti apa. Jadi kayak harus memposisikan ya. Oke, karena semua pembicara sudah memaparkan materinya, kita masuk ke sesi tanya jawab. Saya lihat di chat sudah ada masuk satu pertanyaan dari Restu. Dari Restu, apakah ingin menyampaikan sendiri pertanyaannya atau mau saya sampaikan dulu nanti di follow up oleh Restu ya? Oke, mungkin
boleh Win, kalau boleh diizinkan silakan. Langsung.
Ya, boleh, silakan.
Oke, jadi pertanyaannya ada tiga sih, moga-moga nggak kebanyakan, tapi ini nyambung sih maksudnya. Jadi pertama buat Ines dulu deh, itu kan yang di grafik yang lu bikin Nes, yang di survival analysis, itu yang survival analysis-nya mice yang pakai TEG-11 ya, itu lu pakai Kaplan-Meier kan? Nah, itu yang gue lihat kok, ya cuman yang di belakang doang ya kayaknya yang istilahnya mulai apa namanya mulai significance gitu, tapi yang di awal-awal kelihatannya nggak terlalu banyak bedanya gitu. Nah, pertanyaannya adalah ngetesnya lu pakai apa ya? Soalnya kalau misalnya lu ngetesnya pakai standar yang buat regression model kan nggak bakal signifikan kalau yang dari belakangnya ini kan. Jadi lu cuma ngetes di belakang doang apa gimana gitu istilahnya. Terus yang agak nyebrang lagi di antara Ines sama Joanito nih, itu sebenarnya lebih ke pertanyaan pribadi gue sih. Soalnya gue lagi ngerjain barang yang mirip gini juga. Jadi ceritanya gue punya CD4 nih. Jadi ada beberapa kan dari T-helper cells. Nah, itu di level bulk, itu gue nggak bisa lihat apapun yang ada hubungannya sama apa namanya reseptor. Jadi pertanyaan pertama gue adalah, si reseptor ini tuh sebenarnya in genetic level or expression level kelihatan apa enggak sih? Gitu loh intinya. Itu yang pertama. Terus yang kedua nih, itu yang buat ke arahnya Juanito mungkin adalah, kan gue ngelihatnya di bulk ya, maksudnya. Jadi kalau di single cell, menurut lu bakal kelihatan enggak gitu istilahnya? Istilahnya kan lu have more resolution gitu loh istilahnya. Terus yang ketiga buat Juanito, ini cuma buat ini aja sih, Jo. Apa namanya, gue cuma penasaran sama yang regulon itu, karena gue nggak pernah pegang sama sekali. Apa namanya, itu kalau lu pakai T-Sen bisa nggak ya? Soalnya kalau gue lihat kayaknya separation-nya kan nggak bagus tuh kalau pakai UMAP. Gue rasa mungkin, kalau feeling gue sih, kelihatannya itu cuma gara-gara, mungkin UMAP kan pakainya kan ini kan ya, apa pakai sparse matrix kan, jadi dia yang reduce yang kecil-kecil. Gue pikir kalau misalnya regulon kan harusnya nggak perlu gitu, di reduce pakai sparse matrix itu istilah gue. Jadi kalau pakai T-Sen mungkin lebih bagus. Itu sih, kalau lo ada komentar boleh. Oke, itu pertanyaannya. Jadi gimana? Bu ini silahkan di-manage.
Ya, boleh. Silahkan dari pertanyaan pertama dulu. Mungkin Ines ya bisa bantu jawab, Nes.
Ya, thanks buat pertanyaannya. Itu, untuk yang kapan menit itu sebenarnya kita lihatnya overall. So, it's like as in, is the difference between the survivals over time. Jadi kayak untuk also kayak pas bukan untuk hanya survivalnya, tapi untuk misalnya follow up the tumor progression, gue selalu saya analisisnya pakai mixed models because you look into the difference between the groups over time, over time, so it's like the progress of the treatment over time. Jadi yang dikasih lihat di situ sebenarnya over time differences between the survival and also the tumor progression. Apa tadi pertanyaan kedua?
Pertanyaan keduanya apa namanya? Yaitu sih apa namanya? Kan gue punya sampel yang istilahnya CD4 ya. Dari CD4 itu apa yang dari naif sampai apa namanya yang efektor dan kawan-kawan itu gue nggak bisa lihat bedanya gitu loh intinya in term of expression gitu in bulk. Nah pertanyaan yang buat lo nih yang lebih related buat lo sebenarnya kalau misalnya gue pengen detect ininya reseptornya beda atau enggak tuh kelihatan nggak sih in expression level gitu loh mestinya.
Tunggu pertanyaan balik gue ini lo lihatnya di healthy individuals or cancer related or whatever disease related.
Autoimmune related sih.
Oke, okay. Jadi autoimmune related patients yang dilihat. In terms of T-cell development itself, kan ada juga somatic hypermutation and clonal expansion. Jadi kalau emang sebelum encountered antigens, there is a specific, well not specific, but there is like a multiple different, there is a repertoire just like then you could see within a certain individual in a certain case. But then upon the encounter of antigens throughout the lifetime, there will be a shift in the in the T cell repertoire itself. So then also like for example after the repertoire of the T cells that encounter certain antigens in the tumor, it will be different than the ones in the healthy individual. Ya, tapi kalau untuk mau lihat lebih indeed kayak yang lo sampaikan sebenarnya kalau mau lihat lebih pasti gimana repertoire analysisnya lebih bagus untuk analyze in single cells analysis instead of a bulk.
Ya itu tuh.
Because with the bulk sometimes it's a bit difficult because each of the because each cells might have a different type of repertoire. But then if you do a single cell analysis, it might be better. Then after that, you could sort of extrapolate your data into a bulk effect. I think.
Okay.
Thanks.
Yeah. Ya cuma nambahin dong, tadi kan tanyanya juga ini ya harus dari apa kalau di single cell gimana ya kan. Tapi kalau single cell sih emang kita juga ngeliat T cell itu tapi gue cuma main di colorectal cancer ya, jadi kita juga emang lihat di situ banyak subtype-nya. To be honest, it's not our team that doing this T cell analysis. There is another collaborator in the Belgium. I think she is already doing this for many years, so I think she already tried to label or identify which cell type, I mean T cell cell type are present in the CRC sample, right? Again, it is in terms of healthy and then tumor, right? Jadi bisa ada. Jadi kita ya biasanya kita pakai anotasi dari yang tim yang ada di di Belgium itu. Cuma kalau boleh jujur sih, gue juga nggak expert in the T cell, also immune cell lah in general. Gue mainnya kebanyakan di epithelial, so kalau mungkin kalau buat immune, gue nggak gitu yakin karena gue nggak pernah. Gue tahu juga nih bedanya antara naive T cell sama T cell effector, sometimes juga very blur lah. Lo nanya different immune expert, sometimes they have different opinions juga gitu. Jadi gue juga masih belum gitu jelas. Jadi gue sorry banget nih kita. Kayaknya gue nggak bisa gitu bantu. Mungkin Ines lebih bagus untuk jawab ini. Tapi yang pasti kalau di single cell sih kita bisa lihat ya, ada bedanya waktu itu beberapa untuk T cell. Tapi specifically this or not, nggak ingat gue. Sorry.
Okay. Sorry.
Kalau buat yang UMAP sama TIS nih, sebenarnya sih kalau dulu, kalau untuk di project gue yang kali ini, kebetulan gue juga sebenarnya nggak terlalu fokus untuk di UMAP-nya. UMAP itu cuma buat presentation. Because karena kan kita, gue banyak kan pakai data, single cell tuh very noisy. Jadi kita butuh dimension reduction. Basically kalau kita pakai direct expression, usually resultnya nggak gitu bagus. Jadi biasanya kita butuh dimension reduction using PCA. So the input is no longer sparse matrix actually, it's already in the dimension, reduced dimension in the PCA. But kalau untuk yang scenic or the regular analysis using scenic, right? Actually we don't use any PCA because the number is already very little. The number of regular is already usually around 300 for 200, 300 or 100. So it's not, doesn't need to use a full matrix. Doesn't need to use the PCA anymore. Tapi kalau boleh jujur, kalau buat UMAP, gue juga nggak terlalu fokus untuk mainin parameternya dan juga adjust the parameter. Gue tahu akan lebih bagus, cuma udah ada best practice di field. Dan kita fokusnya bukan di UMAP-nya. Jadi itu cuma small part in the project. It's just like a tool. So kita nggak pernah, gue jujur nggak pernah optimize the parameter. It's just like the one that best practice in the field we just took. Something like that.
Okay. Yep. Thank you.
Yeah.
Ya, terima kasih Restu untuk pertanyaannya juga, Ines dan Juanito untuk penjelasannya dan juga sharingnya ya. Mungkin dari yang lain ada yang ingin menanyakan langsung lagi seperti Restu, karena di chat belum ada pertanyaan tambahan. Kalau ada boleh langsung dibuka, langsung di unmute dan juga tanyakan ke pembicara ya. Oke. Kalau belum ada, mungkin saya yang tanya untuk Stefanus ya. Tadi studinya yang lagi dikerjakan kan sekarang untuk NRF2 knockdown-nya ya, untuk terapi cancer. Nah, ini kan untuk studinya saat ini ya. Tapi kalau misalnya nanti ingin dijadikan suatu aplikasi seperti yang punyanya, yang dipresentasikan Ines untuk imunoterapi, kalau yang NRF2 inactivation itu nanti caranya akan seperti apa ya kalau secara aplikasinya gitu?
Oke, ini sebenarnya juga pertanyaan yang sangat bagus ya. Jadi untuk studinya sendiri, kalau untuk yang cancer itu kita masih development, dalam artian masih ada pro dan kontra tentang apakah aktivasi atau inhibisi dari NRF2 ini yang mana yang sebaiknya dilakukan. Karena di satu sisi untuk cancer sendiri, dia sel cancernya, jadi kalau kita bicara di tubuh manusia, cancernya itu kan mungkin kalau beberapa itu udah terlokalisasi ya, misalnya colon cancer hanya ada di kolonnya. Nah, pertanyaan adalah bagaimana kita bisa spesifik delivery inhibisinya ke colon cancernya aja, tetapi untuk bagian organ yang lain, kita inginnya dia aktivasi, karena ada penelitian terbaru juga yang sangat bagus, jadi tapi saya tidak tampilkan di sini. Jadi di penelitian tersebut, di tikus, untuk yang dia tikusnya sendiri teraktivasi dengan NRF2, tetapi dia menginhibisi NRF2 di bagian kansernya, itu lebih jauh lebih baik daripada tikus yang tidak teraktivasi NRF2-nya. Jadi itu masih salah satu yang masih PR besarnya untuk treatment di cancer. Tetapi kalau untuk treatment yang di bagian lain, kita juga kita di yang untuk isis yang lain, untuk aktivasi dari NRF2 kita bisa menggunakan pardoxolon atau sulforafan, itu bisa diterapkan. Kemudian juga tadi di slide saya tunjukkan juga kita mencoba menginhibisi di cancer juga dengan alt-trans retinoic acid itu bisa menginhibisi dari NRF2 dan juga efeknya bisa mengurangi tumornya. Nah, untuk penelitian saya sendiri, saya juga di sini kita masih berpikir salah satunya adalah mencari bagaimana regulasi dari NRF2 knockdown sendiri. Jadi regulasinya itu salah satunya adalah jika kita punya target gene yang lebih spesifik daripada NRF2, misalnya di case saya, itu saya berpikir untuk targetkan hypoxia inducible factor di bagian stress respond di hypoxia, itu kita berpikir juga untuk menggunakan semacam microRNA delivery, itu juga apakah mungkin, tapi itu juga masih dalam, kita masih studinya masih vitro juga, jadi in vivo juga, dan juga masih, karena akhir-akhir ini juga non-coding RNA, dan non-coding RNA itu sangat hot ya di topik-topik cancer ini, dan juga di berbagai macam disease, jadi kita juga ada kepikiran di sana untuk gimana mendelivery silencing dari NRF2-nya itu sendiri. Itu.
Terima kasih ya, Stefanus. PR-nya masih banyak ya. Nggak apa-apa, berarti masih banyak proyeknya. Oke, okay. Ini dari Berta 2009. Berta, apakah mau unmute dan tanyakan langsung atau mau saya bacakan?
Boleh, kau ini.
Ya, yeah, boleh, silakan.
Thank you. So, buat Kak Ines, again, for someone yeah, who's been kind of leading the scientific world in its sense and roaming about and then going back to scientific presentations, this kind of crawled my brain a bit. So, apologies if this is a stupid question. More like on the application side, if the tech cells are going to be, let's say, sailing through and then going into, let's say, commercialization in the future. So, the cells per treatment, they kind of have to be harvested first from the individual patients, then modified in vitro, expanded or, specialized or differentiated as per your presentation, and then reinfused back to the particular or individual patient. So is that going to be the application in a nutshell? Thank you, Kak. Just so I don't understand. Maksudnya, supaya aku ngertinya benar gitu. Thank you, Kak.
Okay, first of all, there's no stupid questions. So for the first one that we developed, indeed, the one that's phase one clinical trials that's already running is based on autologous adoptive T cells transfer. I mean, we took the apheresis material or the T cells isolated from the patients, and then we engineered them in the lab, and then we transfused back into the patients later on. So this is the concept. But in theory, actually, because generally speaking, I think because in theory the tech cells or the gamma delta TCR itself doesn't recognize their target based on this HLA dependent manner, unlike alpha beta, we are easier to actually implement this method in more off the shelf application, or in this case, later on, the aim is to maybe also have this in allogenic settings. That means you have T cells that are harvested from a healthy individuals, and then after that you engineer them in a big amount, and then you could like easily transfer that into a different patient's populations. In a sense, but at the moment, this is not the case. So for the moment, it still start with the autologous because this is also it's easier in terms of regulatory bodies as a proof of concept in the first in human studies. So you select the T cells from the patients and then bring it back to the patients. Yeah, but that's the idea. That's the concept for now.
Okay, Kak. Thank you. That's clear.
Thanks.
Terima kasih Ines dan juga Berta. Berikutnya dari Pak Raymond ada pertanyaan untuk Stefanus. Pak Raymond, silakan kalau mau unmute, Pak.
Ya, silakan aja Winnie.
Oh ya, boleh. Oke, dari Pak Raymond pertanyaan untuk Stefanus. Belakangan ini berkembang teori antioksidan network ya dari Bruce Ames di UC Berkeley. Apakah knockdown satu gene berhubungan dengan antioksidan itu cukup secara sistem aktivasi oksidasi yang terjadi dalam sel, terutama cancer cells, di mana inisiasi dan progresinya itu meningkatkan oksidatif stress. Jadi apakah cukup knockdown satu gen saja gitu?
Ya, terima kasih Pak Raymond buat pertanyaannya. Jadi sebenarnya yang unik dari NRF2 ini, jadi NRF2 itu dari penelitian yang sampai sekarang masih kita lakukan dan juga penelitian yang sudah dilakukan, NRF2 itu merupakan master regulator dari antioksidan. Jadi dari semuanya, ya pertamanya inisiasinya NRF2. NRF2 ini dengan si protein aktivasi dari NRF2 protein, dia bisa berkaitan dengan antioksidan respon elemen dan mengaktifkan seluruh aktivasinya. Tapi ini juga pertanyaan yang bagus ya Pak, karena ini justru di lab saya ini sekarang kita sedang mengalami problem ini. Jadi kita sedang meneliti tentang tumorigenesis juga, jadi inisiasi dari cancer, seperti yang Pak Raymond juga sekarang tanyakan. Dan ketika kita melakukan mengecek gimana target dari NRF2 ini, protein, bagaimana ekspresi dari protein target yang lain, ternyata itu terbagi gitu Pak. Jadi NRF2 ini dia teraktivasi itu udah pasti, tetapi targetnya protein gen-gen antioksidan yang lain ternyata terbagi dua. Yang pertama adalah gen yang berkaitan dengan ROS metabolism itu justru teraktivasi. Tetapi gen yang tidak berkaitan, tidak berkaitan langsung ya, tidak berkaitan langsung dengan ROS metabolism atau ROS catabolism, dia itu justru tidak teraktivasi atau bahkan justru ter-knockdown, terinhibisi gitu. Jadi ini juga masih salah satu pertanyaan besarnya, tetapi kita sementara ini kita berpendapat bahwa inisiasi dari cancer cell membutuhkan ROS, sehingga ketika sel itu ada di posisi dia oksidatif stres, dia akan meningkatkan pertama-tama adalah gen yang berkaitan dengan ROS-nya harus dibuang dulu. Jadi itu yang sekarang sedang kita pikirkan, tapi juga ini masih PR besar buat kami untuk menyelesaikan ini, karena ini salah satu fenomena yang unik di tumorigenesis. Jadi di mana start point ketika NRF2 itu benar-benar dibutuhkan oleh cancer cell untuk develop, itu kita masih belum tahu. Dan juga gen antioksidan yang mana saja yang diperlukan oleh cancer cell untuk proses development tumorigenesis, itu kita juga belum tahu. Tetapi di akhir, kita sudah tahu jawaban akhirnya, itu adalah di pada akhirnya NRF2 ini akan mengaktifkan seluruh persinyalan antioksidan di cancer ketika udah jadi cancer. Itu yang kita sudah dapatkan resultnya seperti itu Pak. Jadi mohon maaf belum bisa menjawab secara spesifik, tapi itu juga yang sedang kita lakukan Pak. Tapi pertanyaannya ini sangat sangat bagus sekali. Terima kasih Pak.
Terima kasih ya Stefanus. Memang di dalam sistem itu kelihatannya semuanya memang harus membutuhkan ROS. Ini berhubungan dengan inflamasi ya. Jadi tumorigenesis initiation dan juga progression daripada cancer pasti membutuhkan ROS sedikit untuk jump start daripada sistemnya itu sendiri. Nah itu juga dilihat dari inflamasi di kardiovaskular contohnya. Kardiovaskular itu membutuhkan ROS untuk supaya justru antiinflamasinya atau antioksidasinya itu bekerja. Ini memang enigma di semua biological system yang kita belum ada yang tahu nih kenapa. Tapi menurut saya memang area ini sangat menarik untuk dieksplorasi. Kedepannya banyak sekali belum yang terjawab. Jadi artinya itu Stefanus juga masih banyak kerjaan yang mesti dikerjakan. Oke, kasih.
Terima kasih Pak.
Terima kasih Pak Raymond, terima kasih Stefanus. Mungkin karena waktunya sudah terbatas, saya bacakan saja pertanyaan terakhir dari Bapak Taufik dari Universitas Mandala Waluya Kendari. Ini ditujukannya untuk semua presenter, tapi kalau saya baca mungkin nanti mungkin semua bisa boleh berikan komentar ya. Yaitu terkait dengan metode yang sudah dikerjakan oleh teman-teman yang presentasi yang terkait dengan sistem imun, mungkin ini lebih ke Ines ya. Misalkah memberikan kayak penjelasan singkat bagaimana metode tersebut dapat diaplikasikan ke penyakit-penyakit yang terkait dengan virus atau infeksi virus ataupun kanker yang terkait dengan virus ya?
Terima kasih untuk pertanyaannya. So in relations with untuk specifically untuk gamma delta T cells, gamma delta T cells itu and mostly the phi delta 2 negative subsets, memang mereka juga subsets ini specifically juga berfungsi untuk recognize virus specific or tergantung reseptor yang dipakai, dipakai untuk bisa juga aplikasi penggunaan gamma delta T cells ditargeted untuk virus related diseases. So one of the things that's maybe already out there and maybe is already quite interesting is that, for example, the phi delta 1 positive T cells is actually known to actually a bit more enriched in the in the conditions where there is a CMV virus activations. That means it's more active when there is a present, the previously present or the patients or not patients, but even healthy individuals that actually already infected previously with the CMV viral application, but not in the case of there is no CMV reactivation. So in this way, there is a possibility, of course, to then develop these methods further or like really using this gamma delta for a more virus-related diseases, but in terms of virus cancers, in general, gamma delta T cells doesn't, in theory, they don't really have a limitation of what type of cancer that is can be like targeted because it's targeting metabolic changes. So as long as they can detect the metabolic changes that happens in the tumor cells, then in theory, yes, you could also apply to this for virus-related cancers like HPV. I hope that's answered the question. Thank you.
Okay. Oh, ternyata dari thank you ya, Ines dan juga dari Bapak Taufik ya. Dari panitia kasih lampu hijau untuk lanjut sesi tanya jawabnya masih boleh dilanjut. Ini mungkin dari Berta untuk Yuanito ya. Pertanyaannya, in the application of diagnostics, do you propose for single cell RNA-seq at diagnostic for CRC cases? Because MSI is stable or high and also carries a bit of mutation, typing alone may not cut it now based on your new classification proposal.
Oh, ya, makasih buat pertanyaannya ya. Tapi kalau buat yang ini sih sebenarnya kita nggak propose untuk klasifikasi, maka kita harus go to the siRNA for example. Karena kan kita dari siRNA itu kita sudah dapat marker gene-nya, dan juga marker gene-nya ini dapat kita sudah proof juga bisa di-use untuk bulk RNA-seq for example kan. Jadi actually the gene itself is already found that can define these two tumor subtype. Yang perlu diingat ini adalah epithelial tumor subtype. So ini makanya kita juga bilang intrinsic. Intrinsic karena kenapa? Karena epithelialnya. Dan karena CRC itu kan basically yang bikin jadi tumor adalah epithelial cell-nya, jadi makanya kita bilang juga ini adalah the tumor part of the classification. Nah, makanya waktu kita juga coba untuk di bulk, itu kan komposisinya bermacam-macam sel type. Ada yang immune, ada yang fibroblast, ada yang tumor. Tapi ternyata dengan juga pakai marker kita udah cukup untuk bisa lihat dikotominya, itu juga reflek lagi di dalam bulk transcriptomic data. Tapi kalau untuk diagnostic, itu slightly more complicated. Kita juga butuh develop more. Basically, kalau yang paling bagus diagnostik, apalagi kalau untuk di clinical ya, nggak mungkin juga semua patient kamu do bulk RNA-seq, dan kita juga butuh untuk do something yang more simple in the clinical side. Makanya juga kita harus develop some marker, mungkin bisa cuma buat staining and something much simpler, but it's still under development. And then hopefully we can go towards that direction and we can have meaningful diagnostic gene or method that we can use in the clinical. Because one of the our PI, our collaboration actually is a clinician, and then he's also very interested in doing this. And then I think it's not that simple to just do bulk transcriptome, and then it's also very noisy. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Kak.
Pasti berat juga ya untuk ininya, dari cost untuk mengerjakan diagnostiknya kan pasti jadi pertimbangan ya. Yeah. Tapi ya penasaran juga sih, memang tadi juga ingin menanyakan hal yang sama gitu, kalau misalnya nanti untuk aplikasinya kita bisa pakai marker yang mana, karena kan sebenarnya dari banyak transkrip transkrip yang diperiksa yang memiliki profil yang berbeda kan. Jadi ya.
Ya sebenarnya kalau untuk markernya sendiri kita juga emang ada banyak, kita ada sekitar 700-an marker. Tapi kan kita juga try to narrow it down and then try to find the best one at the moment. Actually we have already some of the candidate that we want to test. But again, it will take some time, maybe another study.
Okay.
Sementara ini akurasi paling bagus berapa, Jo? Dari apa yang udah ada?
Akurasi untuk apa nih?
Udah dites belum sih di klinik semua marker yang tadi lu bilang?
Oh, belum dong. Kalau clinical marker it takes time and mesti find patient, mesti find method the suitable right. Kalau lu mau pakai protein kan, kita mau pakai protein atau kita mau pakai RNA, I think RNA hybridization also will not that simple. You need to go to the protein because in the histochemistry is easier in the clinical right. So
yeah,
there's many steps, so takes time.
Oh, thanks.
Saya punya follow up question, Jo. Marker yang di analyze ini kira-kira ada, udah dilihat belum sih ada link to prognosis factor to the patients or not?
Prognostik. Jadi markernya sendiri terhadap prognostiknya.
Okay.
Maksudnya pertanyaan lu adalah gua udah lihat markernya untuk terhadap prognostik directly gitu.
Yeah, single is marker. There any direct correlations to the prognosis of the patients in this case, which is special, maybe specific markers that are found in these patients is better or like a more a favorable prognosis or actually bad prognosis to the patient, is it already looked into?
Yes and no. Kalau misalkan kita bilang secara langsung per gene ya, kita coba correlate untuk prognostiknya, gue rasa sih kita nggak pernah ngelakuin kayak gitu ya. Gue nggak tahu bener, gue at least di lab kita nggak ngelakuin dengan cara kayak gitu. Nggak tahu juga apakah metode itu ada metode yang seperti itu. Atau gue jujur belum begitu familiar. Tapi yang kita lakuin biasanya kita koneksinya itu adalah grupnya. Jadi kan kita bikin stratify. Karena kalau lu pakai single cell atau single sample, it's very noisy. Not to mention even single gene, it will be even messier. I mean, sometimes even in our marker gene for many patients, right, we can see the heterogeneity because CRC is very heterogeneous. So it's not easy to just pinpoint one gene like that, and then it will be too noisy in our opinion lah. Tapi kalau misalnya kita lihat per group, of course we see some pattern. That's why I also show it in the presentation. The I3 is the intrinsic epithelial subtype 3, and then the CMS classification 4, which is the fibrosis subtype. Biasanya mereka punya kecenderungan kalau after relapse, after survival, biasanya dia akan lebih worse. Dan itu yang paling worse basically compared to the other group. Ya kita cuma in the group level lah, in the separate patient, not in the even gene level.
Yeah, no, indeed. Okay, clear. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you Joanito dan juga Berta dan Ines ya. Mungkin ini kalau boleh pertanyaan terakhir dari saya untuk Ines. Ines, penasaran sih. Tadi kan sebenarnya kalau T-cell engineered yang untuk ke apa gamma delta itu kan Ines bilang bisa untuk kanker apapun ya. Nah, ada nggak sih perbedaan ataupun perbedaan kesulitan dalam mendevelop si tech ini antar jenis kanker yang berbeda dan kira-kira itu karena apa? Sama untuk potensinya di klinik sendiri, dia kan lebih spesifik dibandingkan CAR T-cell ya. Nah, berarti benefitnya itu dia selain lebih spesifik juga bisa terinaktivasi ya begitu nggak ada sel kankernya ya. Nah, sama kalau di sana sudah sejauh apa gitu si penggunaan tech ini, dan kalau di Indonesia kira-kira bisa kapan kita bisa mulai menggunakan itu? Thank you.
Okay, pertanyaan yang pertama mengenai aplikasinya sendiri untuk yang dari yang terakhir ya, TEX-001 saat ini sedang lagi dites untuk phase 1 clinical trials in our own institute. So and now we're still studying the dose escalation level and then see how it goes, and then I think we have to see based on the result how to proceed next. Dan untuk aplikasinya sendiri, yes, in theory, the gamma delta T cells is broadly recognized different cancer types. So it's like it's not antigen specific. So application wise, it's slightly a bit sort of preferential compared to this alpha beta that's recognized as single antigen. But of course, in there is still something that we still don't know, because gamma delta T cells, it's still like relatively new in the field. In this case, well, not new in the field, but as in for this type of cancer immunotherapy. So there is still a lot of stuff from the mechanism of the activation or the recognition itself that's still not very well known. I mean, we do have already. Specifically, like for example, the ones that V-delta 2 positive T cells udah lebih banyak dipelajari dan udah lebih banyak mechanism of action that's already found for this particular subset. But if we go to the other subset, so the V-delta 2 negative, in this case is also in our case this Taxol 11 candidate. The mechanism of actions dari subset ini masih sangat limited. Jadi untuk aplikasi yang lebih jauh, mechanism of action has to be really really well known in order to really make sure that later on the drug products that you give to the patient really doing what is intended to do. Like with that note, I think it's really quite interesting that this TX011, because especially it's recognizing these HLA-A2 molecules. Yang menarik adalah actually this HLA-A24O2 is more predominant in the Asian population of patients compared to European. So actually it is more, in my opinion, actually if we could bring that into the Asian population is a lot more applicative compared to the ones in Europe, because there's just really a small populations that you can target with these particular candidates. I think the potential is definitely there. It's just something that we have to still have to study further.
Berapa lama nih sampai bisa selesai clinical trial?
The trial itself is already going on for 2 years, and we already tested 2 dose levels. So then now we are recruiting patients for the last dose level, so the highest dose level. And I think, depending on the results so far, quite actually promising. We are very excited because we finally have one patient that have a complete remission from the leukemia, so it's very exciting. So I think we hope that's after this testing of this last dose level, and then we can go to the next phase of the study.
Semoga bagus ya hasilnya, Nes. Demi masa depan para pasien. Amin. Oke, terima kasih banyak Ines, Yoanito, dan juga Stefano serta panitia dan para peserta alumni lecture series hari ini. Sangat menarik topiknya dan sangat bermanfaat. Nanti misalnya ada pertanyaan lanjutan lagi dari para hadirin, mungkin bisa dikirimkan ke panitia atau bisa juga nanti kontak di belakang slide, nanti bisa dilihat kontak dari para pembicara dan bisa dikontak langsung juga. Oke, terima kasih banyak semuanya. Saya kembalikan untuk acaranya ke panitia ya. Terima kasih.
Yes, terima kasih kepada Saudari Winnie yang telah menjadi moderator pada sesi hari ini. Nah, sebelum kita menutup acara, kita akan mengadakan sesi foto bersama terlebih dahulu. Nah, hadirin sekalian dipersilakan untuk menyalakan kamera dan menggunakan virtual background yang telah disediakan oleh panitia. Kepada tim dokumentasi dipersilakan.
Oke, baik. Kita tunggu dulu ya agar ramai. Oke, sudah siap semuanya ya. Aku coba screenshot dulu dari screen yang pertama. 1, 2, 3. Kemudian lanjut lagi di yang slide kedua. 1, 2, 3. Lanjut slide yang ketiga ya. 1, 2, 3. Sudah.
Okay, thank you, Veda. Nah, sekali lagi saya ucapkan terima kasih kepada ketiga narasumber dan juga kepada moderator yang sudah menyediakan waktunya untuk berbagi dan memandu acara pada sesi acara hari ini di webinar Alumni Lucky Series yang keempat. Nah, apabila para narasumber dan juga moderator ada kepentingan lain, sudah boleh meninggalkan Zoom meeting ini.
Terima kasih ya, Panitia.
Terima kasih semuanya.
Terima kasih semuanya.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Terima kasih banyak ya semuanya. Izin dulu.
Oke.
Terima kasih.
Nah, selanjutnya panitia juga sudah membagikan link absensi untuk absensi dan feedback di bagian kolom chat. Jadi para hadirin diharapkan untuk mengisi link tersebut sebagai salah satu syarat untuk mendapatkan e-sertifikat dari acara sore hari ini. Nah, kita sudah sampai di penghujung acaranya. Terima kasih atas partisipasi aktif para hadirin sekalian. Saya Maria Averia, izin pamit undur diri. Saya mohon maaf apabila ada kata yang salah dalam memandu acara pada hari ini. Selamat sore dan sampai jumpa di lain kesempatan. Terima kasih.